Now, after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye, and believe the gospel." Now, as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said unto them, "Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men." And straightway they forsook their nets and followed him. And when he had gone a little farther thence, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were also in the ship, mending their nets. And straightway he called them. And they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him.
Global and regional conflicts and wars, rising crime and violence, even amongst the young, diminishing trust levels in public officials, and powerful hurricanes like never seen before have instigated fear in people, have undermined the hopes of some and left others traumatized, and have resulted in people asking, "Where is God?" in the midst of their distress. They wonder whether God has abandoned them. The just concluded Christmas season celebrated the Word of God entering those human realities. And by the incarnation, the Word has created for humanity possibilities and opportunities that bring new hope and opportunity for renewal. This third Sunday in Ordinary Time, the Sunday of the Word of God, proclaims that the Word made incarnate is the gift of meaning to humanity. The social and political upheavals in life can make us feel overwhelmed. However, engaging the sacred scriptures, particularly the Easter mystery, invites us to see that despite the present pain, a future is possible. The Word of God made flesh has taught us not to allow sadness or disappointments to put a veil over our eyes and somehow to distort reality. Through his death and resurrection, Jesus reveals to us that although pain, suffering, and death are real, they do not have the last word. And so, the Word of God is our gift of hope. That hope is grounded on God's vision of reality that has been revealed in the ministry, passion, and death, and resurrection of Jesus. With that said, the celebration of the Sunday of the Word of God renews our hope, encouraging us to persist in bringing about the kingdom of God for all people, even in the face of crises and continued resistance. We are empowered to persist in a vision that others might not be able to see, but those of us who see it can help others to see. Our goal is not to correct, critique, or condemn, but we strive towards the fulfillment of God's perfect plan that realizes the full blessings which God has in mind for all people. Because the Word of God took on human flesh and persisted to the end, we too are invited to persist to the end. I wish to encourage all in the different local churches throughout the Antilles Episcopal Conference to join the Universal Church in reflecting on and celebrating the great importance of the Word of God for our everyday living. Wishing all a fruitful celebration of the Sunday of the Word of God. I now present some suggested activities that we can all do for the Sunday of the Word of God. Apart from the usual enthronement and blessings of the Bibles, the following are ideas for the Sunday of the Word of God. In preparation for the Sunday of the Word of God, bishops with the priests and deacons could gather to pray over and study the biblical texts and to share homiletical ideas. This could be the beginning of what can be a weekly, a monthly exercise. Also, in preparation for the Sunday liturgy, parish priests could gather with the pastoral teams to reflect on the readings. Parishioners could be invited to bring their Bibles to Mass on the Sunday of the Word of God to be blessed. Individuals could be given space during the liturgy on the Sunday of the Word of God to witness to how the Word of God has nourished their lives. A procession with an enthroned Bible through the streets of the parish community or church compound could be held before or after the Mass on the Sunday of the Word of God. Small wins should be celebrated. Groups and or individuals who have digested the Word of God and are manifesting its fruits in concrete ways in the community could be recognized. The children, young, and the youth could be given special recognition. A special liturgy of the Word for children could be prepared and celebrated in a space specially prepared for that day. Again, this could be the start of an ongoing children's ministry.
We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words in
sister, or should I say bonjour?
Bonjour. Good morning, Mr. Norville. Lovely to see you.
Yeah, same here. I'm so happy that you're able to take some time off to spend a little time with us and let us know a little bit about yourself. I understand that presently you are in Martinique.
Yes.
Okay, not too far. So close. But as I say, yet so far. The last year has been quite an interesting one for you. We learned that in July last year, that you were elected Superior General of your congregation. Congratulations to you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. The entire year, it didn't quite start that way. The first half of it was quite easy-go-lucky. And in July, well, things changed.
Tell us a little bit about yourself. Your childhood, it's my understanding that you grew up in the community of Babono.
I grew up in Pébouche, in Babono. We moved once, but we remained in the general area of Pébouche anyway. It wasn't too far. I think I was a happy child, self-conscious, curious about people especially, and what motivated them. It has always been a huge curiosity with me about people. I think that I was overall happy, even if I often got into trouble for trying to have my own way, in trouble with my parents, sometimes my teachers and other people. I pretty much had a mind of my own, not so much to the delight of older folks. There's nothing extraordinary about my childhood, except that, you know, I had a grandmother who was doting Well, all of us, actually, my cousins, we played a lot together, explored the bushes and the guava trees and the fat poke and the regular childhood of a person in the 1970s and 80s in St. Lucia, you know. I first attended the Babuno Primary School or Infant School. And then in 1970, when the Lage Combined School was opened, because of where we lived, it was suggested that we should move to that new school. So I went to Lage up to the age of 12, I think. And then went to Corinth Junior Secondary School then. It was a junior secondary school, followed by the continuation of my education at Girls Vocational School. Because I lived in the countryside, I didn't have a lot of time to participate in activities in the city, except maybe when I got a little older. But for the most part, my youth activities were restricted to the Babuno Parish. And I got involved because my teacher in religious education, at the time, I can probably mention her name, she wouldn't mind, Miss Alfia Tench, gave us an assignment to go to our parish. She dared us go to our parish and ask if there was anything that we could get involved in. And of course, like most of my friends, I didn't do the assignment the first week. And I didn't on the second week either. So she threatened that we would fail our religious education course if we didn't do it. So I buckled up and went to the priest. And that's because I wanted to be a singer or a movie star. I had these lofty ideas. And the priest asked me to animate. Of course, that was in my element. I was going to be featuring on the altar, although I didn't quite know what to do. With little time, though, I learned what all of it was about. And I became extremely interested for the right reasons. And so my debut of involvement in youth ministry was from that point on. The years before I joined the convent were really carefree years, eh? Like most teenagers, I think, like most young people, you live today for today. You plan a little bit for tomorrow because the academic framework within which you find yourself helps you to do that. But you don't look very far ahead for the most part. But it was the consciousness of socially vulnerable people that made me aware that I had to be more than just living or existing and enjoying all that there was to be enjoyed. And that consciousness grew my desire and the capacity in me to work with other people. Because I realized very early that it was a huge responsibility to even venture, I don't know, to take care of children or even to be a catechist. So I realized that it's only with other people that you could really make a dent. And so I quickly developed that keenness and the capacity to work with other people towards some form of social change. After that, I with the FMI fathers who were in many of our parishes in the 1970s, 60s, even before that, 80s, they were very keen on vocations awareness. And so very quickly I was asked by the late Father George Guiller whether I would consider becoming a sister. And of course, I brushed it off and said, no, that this isn't what I wanted to do, because I wanted to do everything. I wanted to be everything. Even if I knew it wasn't quite possible, at some point I would have had to make a choice. But he journeyed with us. He journeyed with the youth movement. He journeyed with some of us individually, and exposed us to the wider church. And then I began to understand the role of religious life in the church. I began to visit religious communities, sometimes with him, even just to go to the monastery to buy hosts, was an experience and an opportunity to meet the sisters. And of course, having been educated at the girls' vocational school, I knew the Carmelite sisters and the Marian home. And in fact, I almost became a Carmelite. I expressed my desire to become a religious to the Carmelite sisters and began to journey with them. And close to the date set for the possible entry, I had a change of heart maybe the group of sisters I wanted to be with, or I felt called to be with. And then I was introduced to the Dominican sisters from Martinique. And almost instantly, I felt that this was my place. Now, that does not mean that over the years of living out that life, that it was always rosy and sure that that's where you need to be. Yeah? Life is not like that. But you have nodal points. There are times when you gain clarity. And that first encounter with Mère Jean, Sister Jean Chrysostome from Martinique, was one of those moments of clarity for me. The way she spoke about the human person, and now I know that it's steeped in our own Dominican tradition, our understanding of the human person as integral, as alive, as joyful, as intellect, and also as a moral being, appealed to me very much. And throughout my years of religious life, that has been one of my treasures. After the sisters began their ministry in St. Lucia, they decided to open a novitiate because I was not the only one who was attracted by their spirituality. So they began a novitiate in Souffre. And of course, being a skeptic as I am, I did not want to join them in the first batch. I wanted to taste the pudding first, see what it was like before. So I allowed others to take the first step. And then the year after, in 1983, I joined the sisters. And of course, as everything else, life just happens, time passes. I had, before going to the convent, as I said earlier, I wanted to be and do everything. And it was difficult really choosing one set way of life, especially we were in a small island. And there is a stigma, or there was a stigma attached to anybody who had attempted religious life, priesthood or so, and did not continue. The term that we used in those days was you're a backslider, or you didn't succeed, or failure, you know. So I was a bit afraid of that and the criticism of my friends, because people didn't think that I would remain a sister. But you know what? I didn't know that I would either. I was in for the adventure. I'm a very adventurous person. I was in to discover if that was really what it was. So I did a little gamble, and I made a list of which thing I could do first that would allow me the opportunity. I was very practical, the opportunity to do the other one in case the first one didn't work. So in my calculations, the convent was the safest thing to join, because leaving home And going to live a single life at the time in the 80s was not an option, especially for somebody who lived in the countryside. It would be viewed badly by the community that you go and rent an apartment on your own. Besides, I didn't have money, a lot of money to do that. And my parents would not approve. Getting married, I felt, okay, you become stuck because you committed to somebody in a marriage, in a union that the church sanctions as a sacrament. It's not easy to get out of. And then you have children. You committed to this group of people for at least 30 years of your life. You can't get out of this. So the next best thing was to join the convent. And if it didn't work out, I was already out of my parents' house. Could become a single person living in my apartment. and maybe eventually got married. So I chose the easy way out. And I thought to myself, well, I'll think about it, give it time. The trouble is, now in retrospect, I think that I was in where God wanted me to be because the time passed and I never gave it a thought.
Your home parish, sister, the parish of the Good Shepherd in Babuno, on Sunday the 20th, will be celebrating your achievements.
I'm looking forward to that day. Not because of my achievements per se. I don't think I have achieved anything much. But I think that call to service is what I hope that we can celebrate on the 28th. That each one of us, wherever we find ourselves, whether we practice or not, or whether we are lukewarm, or whether we fully engaged in the life of the church, that we are called to service. And when we touch or when we engage in the service of another human being, it is in the service of the sacred. It is in the service of God that we are engaged. And so for some of us who may have reasons why we don't actively practice our faith, we're not exempt from ministering, from serving other human beings, because again, each one of us is made in the image and likeness of God. We were created and redeemed by God to be with him, so to allow him to love us. And in turn, we learn to love him and to love ourselves, to love other people around us. And so I hope that the focus, even if the occasion is me and my sister's request of me, the occasion will really be for us all to become conscious of our calling to be for one another. I just want to say thanks. I'm deeply grateful. A lot of people have invested in me over the years, beginning with my grandmother, my parents. I'm eternally grateful to both of my parents who are still alive. By God's grace, they're on in years. They have aches and pains, but they're lucid and actively involved in the community of Pébouche and at the level of the parish as well. I'm grateful for the many priests and religious sisters and lay people who have taken an interest in me as a person from my youth and have taken the time to show me some level of care, of tenderness, because we all need it, some affection, have pointed the way sometimes when I have not been able to discern the right way to go. Even those who have said some harsh things to me that made me reflect on the way that I should walk, I'm eternally grateful for all of this. And for the Babuno Parish, I am proud with you because Babuno is a wonderful place. It's green, it's cool, a lot of good food and fruits. But that all of that is in the backdrop. I think we have been greatly blessed in this community. And a lot of good has and continues to come out of Babuno. Babuno continues to produce for St. Lucia, even if, like me today, don't hit the spotlight. we form the fabric too of what St. Lucia has to offer to itself and to the rest of the world.
Thank you so much for spending this little time with us. And I pray that God may continue to bless you and give you your strength as you continue in your ministry and working along with your sisters. So until we meet in Babuno, all the best, sister.
Yes, thank you very much. And I forgot to mention the Dominican Sisters of Our Lady of Deliverance. I am eternally grateful for all that you have given to me, sisters. And thank you very much for this beautiful journey.
Okay, thank you, sister.
Thank you to CTBS and thank you, Mr. Norville, for taking this time.
You're welcome. The full interview with Sister Marie-Thérèse Clement can be viewed on the Archdiocese of Castries YouTube channel or Facebook page.